Okay, Rabbi, we have had so, there's still so many good questions on here, but we have got to get to the hot topic for the day. Who is the Son of Man? Episode 41. This is really cool because Daniel 7:13 is just pushed so hard, especially when it comes to the great revelation with Jesus coming through the clouds. And so, you know, they're thinking, well, it's got to be a supernatural. It can't just be an anointed king. Maybe the right. Who knows? We're going to find out. So, Rabbi, lay it on. No more calls at this point on because I actually waited too long to actually kick this off. So let's just listen to Rabbi Singer go to town on this thing, and we'll see what all we can learn. Sound good, Rabbi?
The term Son of Man in the Christian Bible is used very, very frequently. It appears 86 times. Any 81 of those times in the mouth of Jesus. I'm not going to get too far into that, but it's very, very prominent in the Christian Bible. Trinitarians associate the Son of Man with God. Now, anyone who goes to the Jewish Bible, whether you're going to Ezekiel, is spoken to as the Son of Man, which means immortal, and we can understand why a person, let's just take Ezekiel just quickly. Ezekiel has just described in chapter 1 the most ecstatic vision of the divine chariot in the presence of God. Okay, it is a chapter that is magnificent but impossible to fully comprehend. No human mind can comprehend it. Why is it in the Bible if not every detail can be comprehended? That's not germane to this program. So right away, one might think that maybe Ezekiel was some sort of divine individual to be able to see something so elaborate of God's presence. So right away, bang, as soon as you get to Ezekiel chapter 2, Ezekiel's told he's a son of man. In fact, according to Christian theology, Jesus was anything but the Son of Man. In Christian theology, particularly Matthew and Luke, Jesus was not the Son of Man. He was only the Son of Woman. If he was born of a virgin, he was not the Son of Man. So let's start right there. But that's just a minor point. That's not the key point. Because the term the Son of Man is not what appears in Daniel. It's something like that. It says one who is like a Son of Man. It's not a very big deal, but in Daniel through chapter 7, beginning in chapter 2, not at the beginning, but early in chapter 2 through chapter 7, is in Aramaic. But Daniel has this very important vision, and he has a night vision where he sees beasts emerging, four winds coming. The number four is extremely important to Daniel. It's going to be very important to a number of the prophets. The number four repeated. When you see the four chariots and horses of different colors, in Zechariah, when you see the statue that's in the dream of Nebuchadnezzar in chapter 2, the four sections, the gold, silver, bronze, and then the fourth section, the clay and iron, they don't adhere to each other, the four. These are all the four kingdoms. We are told exactly that in Daniel chapter 7, that Daniel sees in a vision all of time to the Messianic age. And he sees four beasts, and then you look carefully, it says the first one was one that had the appearance like a lion. So the reason why does it say like a Son of Man? Why like? It's like a man because Jesus was really God, but it looked like a man. That's not accurate at all, because if you I could say this to you, whether you're a Christian or not. If you're reading Daniel 7:13, it's fair to say that Daniel expected that you have already read the first 12 passages of this chapter. And that's a fair assumption. If you don't read the first 12 passages of this chapter, it's very unlikely that you're going to have any idea what he is talking about by the time you get to verse 13. So if we view the first 12 passages, so Daniel is having a night vision. This is very gloomy because these are four creatures that are, one is like a lion, like a bear, like a leopard. The lion, the one that is like a lion but has wings, and it ultimately loses its forelegs. It's made to walk on two with the heart of a man. The bear with the three ribs in its teeth. The key point is the first animal represents is like a lion. It's not a lion. Lions don't have wings, but it's like. That's why it's going to be like this, like a son of man, is just as in the first four visions, where Daniel is seeing something like a beast, this particular beast, that represents, in the case of the lion, represents Babylon. In the case of the bear, represents Persia. In the case of the leopard, it represents Greece. The reason why the leopard has four heads is because of Alexander the Great's demise and the Greek Empire being divided into four sections. So those are the first three kingdoms. And then emerges the fourth. And when Daniel sees the fourth, he is absolutely shocked. He's seeing a beast that is really indescribable. And Daniel's, in fact, after Daniel 7:13, I'm not going to go there right now, Daniel's going to ask, I need more information on this fourth beast. So this fourth beast is absolutely horrible. And the angel is going to convey to Daniel that, in fact, these are the four kingdoms. So the four kingdoms, exactly as I've described to you. Now, just like in Daniel chapter 2, where we have the statue of Nebuchadnezzar's dream that Daniel is interpreting for the Babylonian king, that a rock comes, a stone comes, that is not thrown by the hand of man, and shatters the legs of clay and iron that don't adhere to each other. So we have always the fourth kingdom, or the fourth horse, is Edom, it's the fourth kingdom, which is not monolithic, but it's changing, it's morphing, changing constantly. You have the ten horns, the ten emperors, according to Julius Caesar, all the way to Vespasian. That means from essentially the beginning, from the time the Roman Empire enters into Jerusalem, if only Julius Caesar, all the way to Vespasian. Vespasian destroys the second temple. There's a little horn, Titus, who ultimately at that time was a general. So you have here one who's described, who's like a son of man, who is coming with the clouds of heaven. Now, what is he doing coming with the clouds of heaven? And he's coming to the Ancient of Days. Now, the Ancient of Days is God. The Ancient of Days is God. So it's very clear that this one who is like a son of man is not God, because the one who is like a son of man is coming to God. Okay? And then what is then given to him in verse 4 is what we find throughout Scripture about the Mashiach, that all the nations will serve him. He will be the ultimate fulfillment of the Davidic dynasty. This is the final kingdom, the fifth kingdom, and this kingdom will be forever and ever. And there are some Christians who go, what do you mean they'll worship him? It just says that they'll serve him as a human king. And you find many times in the Bible where prophets tell us that certain human kings are going to be served by all nations. Doesn't mean they're God. Is an example. In Jeremiah 27, verse 7, Jeremiah says that Nebuchadnezzar was given this authority and all nations are going to serve him. Doesn't mean that Nebuchadnezzar is God. My gosh, I mean, so getting back here. And then he comes to those who are the holy ones. This is the children of Israel. This is what we find in Exodus chapter 19, verse 5 and 6, that you are going to be a mamleches kohanim v'goy kodesh, a king of priests and a holy nation. And this is the same words, that these are the holy ones, which means that finally, after being trampled by all these four kingdoms, that finally the holy ones, those who are given this name by God right before the Ten Commandments, are the ones who ultimately the Jewish people will be the nation that will, their authority and their malchus and the promises made will be restored to the children of Israel, as prophesied everywhere in all the messianic prophecies, that the children of Israel will be restored to their former place. 10 Gentiles will grab the shirt of a Jew. God is with you. Teach us about God, and so on and so forth. There are some questions here, and that is, why is he coming with the clouds of heaven? Like, some people think that maybe he's coming on the clouds of heaven, like maybe the clouds of heaven are a flying carpet, like if he doesn't have clouds, like that's like his vehicle, he's like driving clouds. So the idea of him coming with the clouds of heaven sounds to people who are not initiated in what do the Anani HaKavod, these clouds of glory, what do they mean in scripture? What does that mean? It doesn't mean he's riding clouds. He's coming with the clouds. What does that mean? What do you mean he's coming with clouds? Why does he need clouds for? How does the clouds have anything to do with this? Well, it actually has everything to do with this. Watch carefully. One who is like a man. Again, the reason it's using like a son of man, Kvar Enosh, Aramaic, is because all the four beasts previously are like these creatures. So therefore, Daniel is using the precise same language. And now the question is, why is he coming with clouds? Now, who is the opponent in the Messianic age as Mashiach is coming? What is going to happen at that very, very moment? Well, we know. We can go to many passages in the Bible, but there are certain ones that are very easy to read. The famed Ezekiel 37. So there the Mashiach is described there in verse 24 and in verse 25. So the Mashiach is coming, who is called the Prince. He's called David. Temple built. And then we get to 38 and 39 of Ezekiel. What do we encounter? We encounter what is known as Gog, or Gog from Magog. What is Gog? What does that mean? I mean, like, who's Gog? Like, if you look on, we may very likely be living at the end of days right now. I mean, it certainly appears to many people of faith that we can hear the footsteps of the Messiah. We can very likely are watching the events that are unfolding quickly before our eyes. Are Jacob's trouble, all this, we're observing this unfold right in front of our eyes right now, in all likelihood. But there's a problem. If you go to an atlas and you look up a country called Gog, you won't find it. So who is this people of Gog coming against the Jewish people? And ultimately they're destroyed. Who is Gog? What's that? So Gog is not a single nation, but it's a confederacy of nations led by Persia, which is Iran. We're told that in Ezekiel 38, 39. We're told about this confederacy of nations. And they're called Gog. Now, what is Gog? What country is that? It isn't a country. The word Gog is a simple Hebrew word. It means a roof. So the word, so Gog means essentially the people of the roof. What does that mean? Who are the roof people? Well, it's good. In a moment, you're going to understand what's happening there. It's ecstatic. There are people who trust in the physical roof, in that which protects them, the reinforced concrete. These are the people who trust in this world, who are bound and connected by this world. And these are the people who trust in the material world are coming up against the nation of Israel. They're coming against the Jewish people. But and those who are the faithful, the holy ones of the children of Israel, what do they trust in? They don't trust in a physical roof because no physical roof could protect us. As we're speaking right now, the European Union is plotting our destruction. The Arab world, a quarter of a billion people, are right now planning how to destroy Israel. This is happening as we're speaking right now in the United Nations. So these nations who trust in the roof are coming up against those people who trust in the clouds of heaven. What are the clouds of heaven? This is where the children of Israel for 40 years went through the wilderness, a desert, and what protected them, what shielded them. They didn't trust in a physical roof, in a Gog. Rather, it was the clouds of heaven that protected them. And in fact, we are told in the Bible that that in fact the Jewish people are to each and every year on the 15th day of the seventh month, they are to go into a sukkah, it's the festival of tabernacles, and they do this because God had protected them. And what is so important about a sukkah? The most essential feature of the sukkah is what? Is the roof of the sukkah. What is it made out of? It's made out of nothing, out of branches. It can't be made out of steel. It can't be made out of concrete. It's just bamboo sticks, just loose branches on top. If a hurricane would come, if any great wind would come, it would be swept away in a second. So the point of the Jewish people, immediately after Yom Kippur, confessing their sins to God, say, repenting for their sins, physically step from their permanent home into a temporary dwelling, and sitting beneath the schach, that overhang which is very fragile, they're saying, we put our trust in the clouds of heaven. And this is what Scripture tells us, precisely why the Jewish people celebrate the Festival of Tabernacles. And now we understand what's going on. What happens is at the end of days, the people who trust in the roof, the Gog, people of Gog, are going to attack the people who trust in the clouds of heaven and the clouds of glory. The Gog, the nation, the enemies of the Jewish people are going to be destroyed. And this is described as you move right through the end of Daniel chapter 7, that this kingdom that is represented by the fourth beast, Edom, will be completely destroyed. And now we move to another chapter in the Bible, a kind of parallel chapter to Ezekiel 38 and 39, in that we have another very vivid description of the war, the final war, that leads up to the Messianic Age. And what is the Bible? This is so delicious. What does Zechariah tell us? That all the nations that stood by Israel, that said to God, I want to be a part of them, that cleaved to the children of Israel, what does it say when Mashiach comes? Each and every year, they'll celebrate which festival? The festival of tabernacles, exactly. They're going to celebrate the festival of tabernacles. Why tabernacles? Why not? I don't know, why not Shavuot? They're celebrating the festival of tabernacles because these are the people who are the survivors of Jerusalem, who defeated the armies of Gog, and therefore the people of the cloud, who trust in the clouds of heaven, defeat those who are the who trust in the roof, in the physical roof, that cannot protect from God. You say, how is it possible for God to defeat so many nations who all trust in the roof? The answer is that what is impossible for man is possible God if you put your trust in him. And that's what Daniel chapter 7 verse 13 is about. Daniel 7:13 is about the Mashiach coming, bringing the Messianic age. He's coming to the Ancient of Days, which is God, another term for God, who is from eternal time. And he will then be made a ruler, which is the Mashiach. He's from the Davidic house. And this is the fulfillment and culmination of all Messianic prophecy, and very specifically the Davidic covenant. What is the Davidic covenant? That's 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 12 through 16, where God promises King David that out of him will come forth all the legitimate heirs to the throne forever. It will never be taken away. And that's exactly what you find at the end of Daniel chapter 7, where we are told in verse 19 and 20 that the beast with the beast will be destroyed completely, and what will happen, and then at the end of days, all the kingship and dominion, grandeur, will be given to this final kingdom. And that's what the one who is coming like a son of man. Why like? We know why, because it's like all the other visions that Daniel had. This is in a vision. Daniel's not standing in the Messianic age. He's seeing a vision. And why is he coming with the clouds of heaven? Because he's coming with the Anani HaKavod. Who is he coming to? To the holy ones. Read Daniel 7:18. Why do they then celebrate Sukkot? Because these are the people who trust in the clouds. And that's why they celebrate the festival of Sukkot. Who do they defeat? Not the people who trust in the clouds, but the people who trust in the roof, and that's God. And bingo, you have a messianic prophecy, and God tells us, I will always be with you, I will keep my promise. And Daniel 7 is an exquisite script of God keeping his promise to the end of days, and may we merit to see the redemption quickly in our time.
Amen.
Adon Olam, Asher Malach, B'terem Kol Yetzir Nivra, Le'et Nasa, B'chev Tzokol, Azai Melech, Azai Melech, Shemo Nikra, Ve'acharei Kiklot Hakol, Levado, imloch nora, vehu aya, vehu ove, vehu ove, vehu ye betifara. Adon olam asher malach beterem kol yetzir nivra le'et nasa v'chefetz kol azay melech shemo nikra ve'achare kichlot hakol levado imloch nora ve'hu haya ve'hu aver ve'hu yehe betifara. Adon olam asher malach beterem kol yetzir nivra le'et nasa v'chefetz kol azay melech shemo nikra ve'achare kichlot hakol levado imloch nora ve'hu haya ve'hu aver betifara ve'hu aver ve'hu yehe betifara. Adon Olam Asher Malach Beterem Kol Yetzir Nivra Le'et Nasa V'Chefetzo Kol Azay Melech Azay Melech Shemo Nikra Ve'acharei Kichlot Hakol Levado Imloch Nora Ve'hu Haya Ve'hu Hove Ve'hu Hove Ve'hu Adon Olam Asher Malach Beterem Kol Yetzir Nivra Le'et Nasa V'Chefetzo Kol Azay Melech Shemo Nikra Ve'acharei Kichlot Hakol Levado Imloch Nora Ve'hu Haya Ve'hu Hove Ve'hu Yehe Betifara. Adon Olam Asher Malach Beterem Kol Yetzir Nivra Le'et Nasa V'Chefetzo Kol Azay Melech Shemo Nikra Ve'acharei Kichlot Hakol Levado Imloch Nora Ve'hu Haya Ve'hu Hove Ve'tifara Ve'hu Hove Ve'hu Yehe Betifara. Chefetzo Kol חזאי מלך, חזאי מלך, שמו נקרא. אדון עולם אשר מלך בטרם כל יציא נברא לעת נשא בחפצה כל עזי מלך שמו נקרא ואחרי ככלות הכל לבדו עם נוח נורא והוא היה והוא עבה והוא יהיה בתפארה אדון עולם אשר מלך בטרם כל יציא נברא לעת נשא בחפצה כל עזי מלך שמו נקרא ואחרי ככלות הכל לבדו עם נוח נורא והוא היה והוא עבה בתפארה והוא עבה והוא יהיה בתפארה והוא היה והוא עבה בתפארה והוא עבה והוא יהיה בתפארה